To load the film holder, you'll pull up on this notch to open it. And then you will take your film and locate the emulsion side. You can identify the emulsion side of the film by orienting the notch marks of the film so that they're on the top right-hand side. When they're on the top right-hand side, the emulsion is facing towards you. You can also identify the emulsion side on black and white negatives by looking for the non-shiny side. The emulsion side is typically not shiny. Place the negative into the film holder. There's a little groove that it fits inside of. Gently close the cover and snap it into place by pushing down on the edges. You can do the same on the other side and load two pieces of film at a time. If you want to clean any dust off of your negative, this is a good time to do it. I'm just using some canned air, and I'm going to give a quick burst of air to dislodge any dust. If you have any severe fingerprints, it's best to clean it before you load the film holder. When you're ready to begin, turn the scanner on. Gently open the scanner bed and remove the opaque cover. Check that the glass is clean. If it's not clean, you can get the chamois from the issue room and gently clean it. Place the film holder so that these arrows line up and the peg fits into the small slot. Then gently close the film scanner. To get started with scanning, you have to open the Epson Scan program. If it's not here in the dock, you can find it under Applications. Here it is, Epson software, Epson Scan. If the program looks like this when you first open it, you need to change it to the professional mode. That's right here at the top, select professional mode. Then we're going to work all of these different settings from the top to the bottom. We're going to select our document type. And today we're using film with a film holder. The film type that we're using today is color negative film. And we're going to scan it in 24-bit color. The resolution should be 300 dpi. And the document size is simply the scanning area. Let's select preview so we can see what the scanning area is. Okay, and now we have previews of our two negatives that are in there. We have a color negative and a black and white negative. You'll also notice that it's upside down. If that bothers you, you can flip it around simply like that. And then we'll select on the other one and flip that around too. You notice that the black and white negative is not showing up so great. That's because the color settings were used to balance the color of that negative. If you have it on the thumbnail view, the program is automatically going to select the image for you. But if you go to the normal view, you can select the area you want to scan. Simply use the cursor Select by clicking and dragging to create a rectangle. I'm going to rotate that so we can see it a little bit easier. In order for the auto color to work, you should not include any of the white borders when you're selecting the image. It will confuse the program and it won't be able to balance the color of your negative as well. So select inside the image area, just like that. The target size of the file should be the size that you want to make a finished print. You can choose from any of the preset sizes, or you can create your own. You'll want your target size to be slightly larger than the final print size that you desire. You can always make a larger scan smaller, but you can't necessarily make it bigger. So it's a good idea to think ahead and think about the largest size print that you want to make. You'll also have to balance your own storage needs with the image quality needs. If you have a lot of large files, it's going to be difficult to store them in the long run. Next, you're going to adjust the color. By default, the auto color has been selected. That's going to automatically balance the color. I recommend using auto exposure whenever possible. And if you want to use these other settings, you can try them out. Histogram will show you the range of different tones and how they show up in the picture. You can see that by changing these sliders, some weird things can happen. The curve setting allows you to control very specific tonality in the picture. These are mostly used for black and white photography. If your color gets kind of weird, you can just reset it by selecting auto exposure again, and that will reset the values. Next up, click scan. It's a little hard to see, and I recommend naming all of your files with your name. You can also select a start number so that each picture has a sequence number following the main title. You'll want to choose a location, and I'm going to put it on the desktop, but you can also select your hard drive. When you're ready, press OK, and the scan will begin. Your file appears in the location that you selected. Looks pretty good. For black and white pictures, it's going to be pretty similar. We'll start from the top. We've got the scanner in professional mode. We've got film with a film holder. Now we need to select black and white negative film. Press OK. And we'll create a new preview so we can see it. So for black and white photography, we're going to select 16-bit grayscale. And we're going to select the image area just like before. We can select our target size just like before. And we can use auto adjustments if we want. Okay. So let's zoom in a little bit to see this image a little bit closer. Auto exposure doesn't seem to do very much for this picture. And so let's look at the histogram. You can use histogram to estimate how all of the different tones are balanced in the picture. You can see here is where the dark areas of the picture are, and here's where the light areas of the picture are. And all of these middle peaks represent the midtones of the photograph. You want to make sure that when you are making a scan that you're recording all of the available information. So make sure that these sliders go all the way to the edge so that no information is lost. If these sliders are too close to the middle, you'll notice that the picture gets high in contrast. Some of those dark areas of information are being lost, and some of the light areas of information are being lost. So it's best to be able to include all of that information in your original scan. You can always adjust it later when you're editing your pictures. If you don't like an adjustment, you can undo it by selecting the auto exposure again. One other way to adjust black and white pictures is to use the tonal curves. Here's a representation of all of the different tones in the image. And if we select one of these markers and drag it up or down, we can control how those different tones are going to appear in the scan. Ideally, you'll want to make sure that all of the tones are being scanned and recorded, so it should not be too high in contrast. But this is a way to more specifically control those different tones. When in doubt, just use the auto exposure, and that will help you get a pretty good image. When you're ready, press scan, and you'll name it just like you did before, with your name. Select a location, currently selected to the desktop, which you can select your hard drive. And press scan when you're ready. Okay, so now our images have appeared in the location that we chose on the desktop in this example. And you can see that each one has its sequence number after the title. This is a really great way to keep your scans organized, and you can rename them later when you have more time. When you're finished at the end of the day, it's a good idea to do a blank scan because your previews will still appear when the next user logs onto the computer. So if you don't want the next person seeing your picture, you can make a blank preview scan to clear out your image from the program. It otherwise saves it, and you might not want to have your images out there for other people to see. So that clears the images out of the program, and now you're done. You can quit the program and be sure to turn off the scanner when you're done. That's how you do it.